Hello from Chem Help ASAP. This video describes the discovery of JTE-151. This compound is an inhibitor of ROR-gamma, an orphan receptor that has been linked to certain autoimmune disorders. The video reports the discovery program of JTE-151 as described in a drug annotation article in the Journal of Medicinal Chemistry by scientists at the Central Pharmaceutical Research Institute in Osaka, Japan. The citation is at the bottom of the screen, and a link to the article can be found in the video description. This video does not describe every aspect of the article. I have selected the parts I consider to be the highlights that best summarize the project and fit within the medicinal chemistry class I teach. Let's begin with autoimmune disorders. These are conditions in which the body's immune system attacks healthy tissues through unregulated antibodies. It is estimated that 5% of the population in the Western world is affected by autoimmune disorders. Some of the common examples of autoimmune disorders are Crohn's disease, rheumatoid arthritis, multiple sclerosis, psoriasis, and others. Therefore, autoimmune disorders represent an important unmet medical need. There is a promising target for autoimmune disorders. That target is ROR-gamma, which stands for retinoic acid-related orphan receptor gamma. This receptor regulates T helper 17 cells, which are implicated in autoimmune disorders. Fortunately, there are X-ray structures of ROR-gamma, or at least the ligand-binding domain of the receptor, as well as co-crystals of receptor-ligand complexes. At the bottom of the slide is the structure of retinoic acid. This is an orphan receptor, so the endogenous ligand is not known. Regardless, based on the name of the receptor, I don't feel like it is out of place to show retinoic acid as a relevant ligand. Based on the structure of retinoic acid, we might expect ROR-gamma ligands to be largely lipophilic with a small polar region. And that's largely what we'll see in this research article. Here are two known ROR-gamma ligands. This GSK compound on the left has been in the clinic. It is a topical compound for the treatment of psoriasis, so it's not orally available. I do not believe the compound on the right has been in the clinic, but it is regardless a potent ROR-gamma ligand, so there is good precedent for designing potent ligands for this target. Designing ligands with ADME and PK properties for systemic exposure, however, has been a serious challenge. Now, this finishes the introduction and background material. Let's now talk about what the scientists at the Central Pharmaceutical Research Institute did. The results and discussion section opens with some mention of the primary assay that was used to screen for active compounds. The primary assay focused on IL-17, interleukin-17, which is a pro-inflammatory protein. IL-17 is produced by the T helper 17 cells. Therefore, the primary assay involves incubation of PMBCs, peripheral blood mononuclear cells, which include T helper 17 cells. These cells are incubated with test compounds and then monitored for IL-17 levels. Compounds with lower IL-17 levels are presumably inhibiting ROR-gamma in the T helper 17 cells and suppressing IL-17 release. By no means do I have expertise in assay development, but it is important for medicinal chemists to at least have a fundamental understanding of the assay readout in a program. The drug annotation article does not go back to the beginning of this drug program. Instead, the article intercepts the program at a later stage. The early work is referenced through the link below. The early work revealed compound 3. In the current work, the article of this video, the researchers simplified the structure of compound 3 somewhat by opening the pyrrolidine ring. Several structures of compound 4, type compound 4, were synthesized. Compound 5 emerged from a scaffold hop, replacing the 1,2,4-triazole with an isoxazole ring. The paper does not declare compound 5 to be an official lead, but I'm going to call it the initial lead compound. It seems to be the most critical chemical starting point for the article. The compound has very good ROR-gamma potency with an IC50 of 55 nanomolar. It also has good metabolic stability and membrane permeability, which will hopefully translate into reasonable oral bioavailability. For optimization, the researchers focused on four different parts of the structure. First, this carboxylic acid side chain. Second, other options for the cyclopropyl group. Third, the alkyl group on the left side of the structure. Fourth, substituents on the N-aryl group. I'll shorten the discussion a bit. The researchers were unable to improve on the cyclopropyl group, so we will leave that group in place for the rest of this video. Let's now look at the left alkyl group. On the screen is a table with just four different alkyl groups, including the isobutyl group from compound 5. Now we have some numbers for the metabolic stability of 5. So this column is metabolic stability reported as the percentage of compound remaining unreacted after being incubated with liver microsomes for 60 minutes. Membrane permeability was determined through a KCO2 assay. Through changes to the alkyl group, the researchers did find compounds with increased potency, not much change to metabolic stability, but with reductions to membrane permeability. In the end, the team selected this neopentyl group in compound 6A as the best balance of the three criteria: potency, metabolic stability, and permeability. Moving to the acid side chain, again, we'll use compound 5 as the baseline. The discovery group did look at a number of different side chains, more than I am showing here. The most potent compound in this series was 8E, but the loss in membrane permeability was deemed too great. In the end, 8A, with just one additional carbon from compound 5, was selected. Compound 8A has a modest gain in potency, with some loss in terms of metabolic stability and permeability. So this decision gives the sense that boosting potency is the main priority, but losses to membrane permeability and metabolic stability should be minimized if possible. Our last group to be examined is the N-aryl ring. Again, compound 5 is the standard. Almost none of the different substitution patterns on the ring improved potency. One of the very few is compound 9M, which really is barely a change from compound 5, just an isosteric substitution of the orthomethyl with an orthochloro. The potency gain is modest, with some loss of metabolic stability and permeability. With new optimized R groups for three parts of the compound, the researchers turned the attention to the isoxazole core. So the last step was a scaffold hopping exercise. Here are four of the various analogs. First, we can see that the potency of the optimized isoxazole with all the ideal groups has gone from 55 nanomolar down to 13 nanomolar in compound 10. That is a four-fold boost from the original lead, compound 5. Two promising core scaffolds, including different isomers of the 1,2,3 triazole ring in 11A and B. These were very comparable to compound 10. Compound 11D, a pyrimidine analog, has good potency but gave away too much in terms of metabolic stability. In the end, the team advanced compounds 10, 11A, and 11B into in vivo PK studies. Here we have the PK data for the three compounds. The study involved dosing rats, a single 1 mg per kg IV dose, and a single oral 3 mg per kg dose. Although the in vitro metabolic stability of the three compounds is very similar, the in vivo half-lives vary, with compound 10 being much better. Compound 10 also has a much higher oral bioavailability, essentially complete absorption. So based on these data, compound 10 was advanced into in vivo efficacy studies. For efficacy, the researchers used an animal disease model in mice. So the mice had an induced condition, EAE, experimental autoimmune encephalomyelitis. This is a model for multiple sclerosis, an autoimmune disorder. So the disease state is induced, and the animals are monitored for their interleukin 17 levels. The study included a sham group. These are healthy, untreated animals. The vehicle group has the induced condition, but no treatment. There were also two treatment groups with different doses of compound 10, either 3 mg per kg or 10 mg per kg. The IL-17 levels were monitored in both lymph nodes and the plasma. These IL-17 levels are italicized because the numbers are being read by eye off a chart in the paper. The actual values are not reported in the paper or in the supplementary information, so there will be some uncertainty in these numbers. As you can see, the treatment groups showed reduced IL-17 levels, reduced much below the untreated group, but not quite as low as the sham group. These are the only two dose groups mentioned in the paper, but there does seem to be a dose-response relationship. Based on these results, compound 10 with a research designation of JTE-151 was considered as a clinical candidate. In addition to its promising PK and in vivo efficacy, JTE-151 had good selectivity for ROR-gamma over other nuclear receptors, low activity in standard safety panel assays, low HERG channel activity, and no mutagenicity. The Drug Annotation article does disclose some early PK data from Phase 1 clinical studies. With an oral dosing range from 30 milligrams to 1600 milligrams, that's about a 0.5 mg per kg up to maybe 20 to 25 mg per kg. JTE-151 showed dose-dependent plasma exposures and no serious adverse events. The studies are ongoing. The compound does not appear to be listed in clinicaltrials.gov, but of course the clinical trials may be conducted in Japan, the country in which the non-clinical research was performed. Thank you for watching to the end of this drug discovery story on JTE-151, an orally available inhibitor of ROR-gamma. A link to the original JMedChem article is in the video description. Please consider subscribing to the channel, leaving a like, or making a comment. Take care.